Matt Corman, executive producer of Containment.
Chris Ord, executive producer of Containment.
Thanks.
You guys on the same show?
No.
for a while.
Yeah.
So how did this come about? I mean, what's sort of this project?
So for us, this came about because we knew Julie Black, who adapted the Belgian format for a long time, and always have wanted to work with her. And when we came off our last show, Covert Affairs, we were really looking for someone that would be exciting and interesting and challenging to us. The Belgian series this is based on is really amazing, and Julie kind of took it and projected it forward in a way that's really exciting. And for those of you who don't know, it's about a sort of science fact concept of a Ebola-like outbreak that happens in Atlanta, and they cordon off part of the city, creating a quarantine zone. So people are separated from one another that would not want to be separated, loved ones, etc. So it kind of creates a crucible for amazing storytelling.
And as Matt said, it's science fact. Like, this sort of thing goes on today. It just happened in Sierra Leone in 2014. And yet, if it happened in this country, it'd be a major deal. And so that's sort of what we're exploring, is what would happen if this actually occurred in Atlanta.
So we're not talking like supernatural zombies.
The monster in the show is the virus itself. Okay. And it's a terrifying virus. You don't want to get it.
Right.
And if you do get it, it's basically 100% fatal.
Right. But you're right.
Quickly fatal?
What's that?
Quickly fatal?
Within a couple of days.
Okay.
Yeah. But I think you're bringing up a key component of the show that may separate it from some other shows that might seem similar, which is we're always driving towards what could really happen in real life, and that's scary enough. And when you die, you're dead in this show.
If anything, it's scarier in the sense, like, you know, if you project yourself into it, it's like, oh shit, this could really happen.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Being so reality based, how closely did you follow what the CDC or like government procedures would be for this?
Well, we do a lot of research. I mean, we did on our last show, and we did now. We've been, you know, talking to the CDC, reading as much as we can, bringing in experts to the writer's room, just so we feel, because if it's as grounded as possible, it's going to feel as real as possible, and therefore it'll be as scary as possible.
What do you think will draw the audience to the show?
The audience of the show?
Yeah.
Well, I think what's interesting is I think we're going to expand the CW audience as one might understand it now. Our cast is terrific. They're very diverse and very captivating. And they are going to draw in hopefully new viewers as well as capitalize on the existing viewers in the CW. But this is a pretty sophisticated show, pretty dark show, and it's pushing the envelope in an exciting way, I think, for this network.
Do you feel that there's a real underlying fear in people? I mean, obviously you hear Ebola, but it seems so far away. But there have been all these shows like now, Last Ship and Helix. And,
right.
And I'm not talking about the sci-fi element, just the fact that the notion of a... it's very real. And I think, you know, if it caught us by surprise, a situation like this could very well happen. And I think that's what makes it so visceral to watch and to go through. It's really a fascinating subject.
I think people are concerned about getting sick, you know, and I think it's not an unfounded, unwarranted and ungrounded concept. You know, people are, you know, we're living in the Purell generation. You know, people are really attempting to avoid just not only the flu, but these other things that are out there. And the scary thing is the more experts we talk to, the more scared I've become, because it seems that this is a much more likely scenario than I would have thought.
When you cast everyone from episodic guest stars to extras, do you have to teach them all how to play the symptoms? So it's
there's a process, and David Nutter shot the pilot, and he had worked with makeup people. I think they had about 72 meetings or something during prep to really get down on paper what the different stages of the disease are. So as the 48 hours progresses towards fatality, stage one, you have a little bit of stuff coming from your nose and eyes. And then like stage two gets even more intense, stage three. And so now we have all those references as we break the stories going forward. And they have it on set, so as they do the makeup for the actors coming on, they'll know what stage they're at.
Right. And then also, within, to your question, we have to sort of say, as the cordon is developing, as the people are trapped inside, what life looks like. When you run out of milk, when you run out of water, when you run out of food, things like that. So we have to kind of track all that.
Are there any other rats named after different pop music stars?
Probably down the road, there'll be more rats. So, all
so
right.
You guys have seen it?
You've seen it? Yeah. Okay. Great. Well, if you guys get a chance, come tonight. We're doing another screening at 6:15.
So is the dramatic thrust, though, just these people living within this contained area?
Inside and out. Okay. You know, what's, I mean, I think what makes it a Julie's show and what we really respond to and what the way we like to write is there's very human stories being told here. I think what we love about it, it's not just death, death, death. It's people actually struggling to live. It's the humanity of people in a situation like this doing the right thing, helping when you know, they should actually be saving themselves, being selfless enough to help somebody else. All those human stories that play out in this condition are the most fascinating, really.
Can you talk about a little bit of the relationships? Who are you meeting these characters in the world?
Sure. So there's some really interesting storylines. There's a cop who's separated on the outside, and he's in a unique position. That's Lex, played by David Jesse. So, and his girlfriend is inside, so that creates a real strain on them. Meanwhile, one of his best buddies is a cop who's trapped inside. You have a doctor inside, one single doctor who's in a unique position to try and figure this out from the inside. So I think what is really interesting is we tried to kind of maximize these relationships and put strains on them.
And the relationships that develop when they normally wouldn't. There's a relationship between Chris Wood and Kristen Gutowski, who she's a school teacher of. She's a school teacher. She's in charge of all these kids, and he's a cop. They normally wouldn't pass each other and have that relationship in real life, but this is important.
All right. Well, thank you.